Good morning, everyone. This is Jeffy Kennedy, author of Fantasy Romance and Romantic Fantasy. I'm here with my first cup of coffee, which, if you're on video, you'll see has an extra flip of foam this morning. I might have to stop using the foam spinners, but I like them. It's just pure 2% milk. Well, and some stevia. But I don't think the stevia would create a meringue effect. I did a double latte this morning. Am I doing that every Friday? I have my Friday tired. Speaking of which, I already blew the lead, L-E-D-E, but it's Friday, May 21st, and I have scoogies all over me. I have lots of scoogies on me. My leggings, for some reason, have these particular leggings get cat hair on them. Even they come out of the laundry with like little bits of rolled up cat hair. Is there a word for those things? You guys, cat owners, know what I mean. It's like they transform from cat hair and become a particular kind of lint. Loving that coffee. So it's a gray and overcast morning here, but not yet raining. We're supposed to get more rain today. I know, lots of rain. My nose is itching. But not tumultuous this morning. It's kind of the peacefulness before a soft rain. Yeah, right. Birds are quiet this morning. It'd be nice to get some more moisture. Yes, singing their songs. Hope you are singing your songs this morning. I'm feeling like I'm quiet, and I'm reminded that I need to maybe move this thing closer so that I'm not so quiet. I think I might be quieter voice-wise outside just because I feel like I could be overheard, which I know is this weird psychological thing. Feels good to sit out here in the quiet. So I crashed yesterday. I had a real crash day. I went to Writer Coffee. I did not get words before Writer Coffee. I got this posted, which I know makes people happy if I get this posted before I go, but it ends up, I should probably prioritize getting some words before I go because it does make a difference. And then I sat there too long. I had a good time talking with my friends, which I guess that's worthwhile too, right? But I didn't leave there till 11:15. We started at 9, so I sat there for over 2 hours gabbing. And Dorinda was laughing at me when I got home. She's like, "You took the whole morning off." I'm like, "Yeah, I kind of did, didn't I?" And I thought, well, it was unusual for me not to be feeling the itch, the push to get back and get to work. And so then once I did get to work, after relaying some urgent gossip to Dorinda, there I was still chattering on. We didn't start till noon. 12:05, I think, was our start time, which is, boy, if I don't start till then, it's kind of kiss of death. But then I was also thinking that maybe part of the problem was, part of the reason that I was yakking and procrastinating so much was as I was pretty empty. I'm at a sticky point in the book. I'm still figuring out what's going to happen. I've had some new characters arrive, and I'm not sure what their agenda is, and I'm having to deal with them. And I don't think I'm fighting it, but I might be thinking too much. My contact lenses are bothering me. This is another aspect of my life. I need to get some enzymatic cleaner for them. It's a total aside. So I did write for 2 hours and I got a grand total of less than 500 words out of my 2 hours. It was just my brains were empty. There were no words to be had. Oh, now this eye is bothering me. All right, hold on. Okay. I think I have my eyes handled now, at least. I know you all are relieved. So, oh yeah, so I didn't even try for a third hour, I told Dorinda. I'm just empty, I'm tired, and I had nothing. I just had nothing. Some days you have nothing. So then she said, well, do you want to, because we're doing our Tuesday, Thursday evening thing. She said, you want to not do tonight? And I said, well, let me see. But then I ended up texting her and saying, no, let's not do tonight. Let's just bail on it. So we'll see. Hopefully today is better. I am thinking about the story this morning. So that's always a better sign. I wouldn't worry about it so much, except that we have these guests coming next week. They arrive on Sunday. And we're going, taking them around and doing stuff. And I just don't, I'm not anticipating getting much written, which I did schedule in. But if I'm losing yesterday and today, then that puts me behind ever so slightly. But it is what it is, right? And hopefully it'll be fun. I know I don't sound very enthused. Yeah, I hope next week will be, that I could treat it as a vacation. I also have release day Tuesday, and my publicist is sending me last minute assignments, like writing essays and coming up with stuff. So I have to be working on that. I'm not going to say anything more than that. I may say something more at a later date, but I keep thinking of that sign that people used to have over their desks. Maybe they did one at my day job that was like, poor planning on your part does not constitute an emergency on my part. And yet in this case, it's become my emergency. So, let's do earrings. I'm wearing very perky earrings, though I am not personally perky. These are my Red Hot Chili Pepper earrings, which I've had for much longer than I've lived in Santa Fe. And I don't remember where they came from. I think someone gave them to me. But they are like little, I think they're plastic, paper mache? I'm not sure. Probably paper mache. Red Hot Chili Pepper with, and they're about, I don't know, 3-4 inches long with a little green top. They're very light, which is nice for that earrings that big. But the posts are very poor quality metal. So I can wear them for about an hour before my skin allergy starts to kick in and they start itching. My metal allergy, whatever that is. It's probably made out of like radioactive lead from China. Did you see what I did there? We watched an interesting movie last night that David picked out that had a lot of did you see what I did there in it. And it was 21 Bridges with Chadwick Boseman. The last movie that premiered, that went live, that people saw before he died. And that's really unfortunate because he really is a fine actor and he did a good job in this movie. And when David put it on, I had exceeded, you know, and said, you pick something, you pick what you want to watch. And he, when I saw it was going to be a police thing, I was like, oh, great. Just what I want. A thing about cop killers and all of this. But it was really good because Chadwick Boseman is the son of a murdered cop who becomes a cop. And he is known for being willing to pull the trigger. He's killed like 9 people in his 10-year career. And which is part of why I was dubious to begin with, because I thought this is not the kind of person that I find heroic. But he was very, very much a believer in the police and them and doing the right thing. And at the beginning of the movie, and I feel like this is not a spoiler because it's just in the blurb and all of that sort of thing, this group of cops, like 8 cops, get killed by the bad guys. And Chadwick Boseman is chasing them down. But it becomes much more nuanced than that. And not all of the cops are good guys. And I apologize if that's a spoiler, because it may be slightly. But I don't know, maybe you would think that, you know, it's not unusual to have a movie where that happens. So I feel like that's a little bit on the tropey side. But, and I won't spoiler more from there. But one thing that was very interesting and would be interesting to listen to, and maybe someone else has gone through it, the IMDb trivia didn't have it, which I think just supports the fact that it's all like neckbeard trolls who put in the trivia there and not people who actually follow political nuance. But there were a couple of lines in there where the cops were going after people and they referenced some of these famous recent events where Black people have been killed by cops. And for those who don't know, Chadwick Boseman is a Black man. And like there's one where they rouse this guy out of bed and they're wrestling him down and he says, "I can't breathe." And then there's another point at which a guy is killed and a young Black woman steps forward to help and the cop stops her. And she says, I'm an EMT. And she says it much more articulately than I did. She says, "I'm an EMT." And he stops her anyway, which is a clear reference to another one of the riots where the young Black man bled to death because the cops would not let a young Black woman EMT go treat him. So there were some really interesting political nuances in there that if you have been paying attention to those kinds of things, I was glad that they threaded that into that movie. But I was thinking a lot of people who recognize those things would not watch the thing about the cop killers in the first place. But it was a really good character arc for Chadwick Boseman. Really well done. 2 thumbs up. I can't do one of them very well because I'm clutching my latte. So then yesterday afternoon, I ended up just sort of, David came home and he made me a nutritious lunch, which did help. He's like, "Maybe you need some good food." I was like, "What? I can't live on coffee." and he said, "Maybe you need to rest." And so I did. I just rested in the afternoon. And I sat out in the sun. It was a very sunny afternoon. It was lovely. And I've been in a bit, I don't want to say a reading slump. And I know I said that before, and then I found a couple of books to read, and they satisfied me. I haven't found anything in a while that's just really lit me up. And that could be me. I might be just kind of depleted. But I broke down and bought Fugitive Telemetry, the new Murderbot novella, which I had been resisting buying because it's $12 for a novella, and it makes me so mad that Tor is doing that. Even though Tor McMillan is also my publisher, my books are not $12 ebooks, which I'm not bitter about. I don't want them to be $12, but clearly they can get it. And we all love Murderbot. And so it was fun to read Murderbot. I love the story. I like the snarky humor in it. And then Martha Wells, the author, is just a really tight writer. I wish I could find more sexy fantasy romance that's really tightly written. I mean, there's some, But the stuff that really hits my sweet spot, genre-wise, is not as always tightly written as I would like. Some of these books I read recently that I liked the theme, I liked the sexiness, and I liked the premise, the magical premise, but then the world building just falls apart. And these were books that, you know, are in Kindle Unlimited, and I know that that books in the subscription programs are not rewarded for being really tightly written or for having really deft and tight world building. So, you know, in some ways I don't blame the authors, because why do you put a bunch of effort to something that people don't care about? But it's interesting to me that I feel like we're getting this very segregated audience out there, where you have people who will buy the Murderbot novella for $12 on Kindle, or even more for like the collector's editions, hardcovers. And then you have people who will read only on Kindle Unlimited for their $9.99 a month and will not buy a book outside of that. And then you have people who will only read pirated books, but those are pond sludge human beings, not even worthy of the term, so we don't even count them. But, you know, it's interesting because the different audience, the different price points and accessibility, and I feel wrong using the word accessibility, because I don't mean in a ability sense or disability sense. I mean in a medium. I guess that's why I want to say the medium. That the medium and the price point is creating that certain kinds of genres and certain kinds of, I don't know, story appeal are segregating out into these different price points. Maybe that's always been the case. I don't know. Mama Wren feeding the babies. So, it would be interesting to see. I just kind of wonder what the long-range demographic implications of this are going to be. Because I think we're already seeing it, that, you know, like I'm talking about, like with Kindle Unlimited, you're rewarded for basically inhalability of the story, which does not encourage complex world building. And unfortunately, people who are, I mean, I think you could have a simply built world and have it be, still have it have logical sense. It drives me crazy when the world building is shoddy. I read one recently where the heroine wore corsets for no discernible reason. There were no other costume related, fashion related. There was nothing else about this world that dictated the wearing of corsets. And she seemed to be the only one who did. And it seemed only because, like, she is a princess and princesses wear corsets. I mean, it was just, it wasn't wrong, but it was like the author never gave it thought. Like, what is the dress code for this world? What are people wearing? You don't really know what people are wearing other than the fact that this gal wears corsets for, and then like sometimes she is and sometimes she isn't. And later she makes a decision to stop, but it's like she was never wearing one consistently to begin with. It was just, and I'm probably the only one who notices these things, but it irritates me on a world building level. So there we are. All right. I am going to hopefully get to work. Cross your fingers for me. And I probably will not be here on Monday. So sorry, Mom. I know that people besides my mother watch this show, but my mother will be upset with me. She will have to live. So I hope you all have a wonderful weekend. I hope you get accomplished what you want to get accomplished. I hope you also get to have some fun. Read a book that you love. I'll remind you that First Cup of Coffee is part of the Frolic Media Podcast Network, and you will find more podcasts you love at frolic.media/podcasts. And I will talk to you all Tuesday for sure. Take care. Bye-bye.